It's become popular to ask this question. I think it's a good question. If someone were to come up to you, knowing you're a very regular churchgoer, knowing you come to the St. Petersburg Seventh-day Adventist Church that prides itself in having a good amount of truth to lean on and talk about and praise God about, if someone came up to you and knew who you were and said, "What do you know for sure spiritually?" What would you be able to say? We're asking that question of ourselves in secular spaces. What, as a human being, do you know for sure? And if you know it for sure, how are you saying it when you answer the question? If you know it for sure, you have some passion about speaking it. You know, if you, whatever you know for sure, you can have a long conversation about. Whatever you know for sure, you light up about it. So, and we either just know it for sure or we don't. It's your life experience, so there's no guilt about it. It just is. What do you sincerely know for sure? You've been a Christian for quite some time, or maybe you're just coming into spiritual conversations and you're learning so much. What do we know for sure, family of God? Listen, this is the time that she predicted about. This is the time. For they will run to and fro, and knowledge will increase. When we teach our children in school, we teach them differently now than we ever used to. We really do. We have computer and laptop, and this, to have a computer and a laptop in school is just monkey's play right now. We're going into whole new spaces with education where knowledge has increased and abounded so much so that information, you can be an expert on anything in five clicks of a button and have the latest thought out there in the world. So with all this knowledge that has increased, has what you know for sure to be true become more solid? Or are you still wondering what you know for sure? Just think it's a good question. I myself think it's a good question. And I am excited about what I think I know for sure. Amen. And I am still learning about what I think I know for sure. Because I think it has so many applications. It has so many applications to every part of my life. And I am pumped up to keep learning and learn with you, because I do believe that the ground of life is fertile, meaning your life experience and all the choices you have to make and all the problems you're dealing with and on all the heartbreak you're facing in the midst of bodies that fail us, we are figuring out a lot. And what I like to call, that what our church likes to call, and what the Bible likes to call the great controversy, the great battle between good and evil. You got goodness, and you got evil, and there's a war going on with good and evil all over. Every movie depicts this conversation in every culture. The battle between good and evil is played out every day in my life and in your life. And we are still wondering, in this fertile ground of our life experiences together, what do we know for sure in it all? What do you know for sure in all? And listen, our young people are facing this significantly, because they have heard us share through the course of history, pass like a baton down through the course of time, that hopefully those religious people over there have some answers to what they know for sure that will help me in how I live my life. And we try to pass the baton of what we know for sure down from generation to generation, and it's just hard, isn't it? It's kind of hard to pass it on. And just think about where you got it from and how it came across and how it's still coming across. Father, help. Father, help. For certainly there is a God who knows for sure. Certainly there is that space we can tap into. Let's talk to him right now. Dear Father in heaven, we've come into your sanctuary pondering a very important question that is on all our hearts all the time, and we are always coming up with answers in our mind on this continuous journey of the answer. And dear Father, we ask your Holy Spirit to come into this place right now, right here, right today. Open up our minds and our hearts again. Dear Father, draw us together as a community that this very important question can be at the tip of our conversations all the time together, generation to generation, heart to heart. Dear Father, we love you, and it is in Jesus' name we pray. Yeah, we keep learning more and more. We are at a day and age where now we have sent things up into the sky. We've learned so much. We've built some things, and we've sent them up into the sky that surround our Earth and our globe because it's hard to see. It's hard to see from a limited point of view. We want to see more, thinking if we see more, this is going to help us know for sure more, a lot of things. Because we have things we want to do. We're moving to and fro faster and faster so we can see more and do more, because that's just fun. So we put a satellite up into the sky. Anybody know how many satellites we have up in the sky nowadays? Hundreds. Hundreds. Okay. That's a lot. I don't know the number. I just wondered if you knew the number. But we have enough up there. We have enough up there that we can do some really cool things now. It's not only for government usage now, it's in our very own hands, in our very own pocket, in our cars. Now they're wanting to put it into the car, not just attached to the car. The global positioning system helps us know all kinds of things nowadays, yes? Wow. So it really helps me every day get from home to anywhere I want to go in the world. And do you lean on that when you drive around a lot more than you ever used to? I lean on it all the time. In fact, I love it because I like to not even think. Okay, it's not hundreds. 2,271 satellites float around the Earth. Isn't that something? We put them there. It's not a natural occurrence. We put them there. And it helps us with a lot of things, okay? It helps us to know. It helps me, little Jennifer Scott, know how to get from my little home to, last Thursday, I had to go to Orlando for a particular meeting, and I didn't know where I was going. It was a new path because it's different from where I was, and to help me navigate the traffic and the other side and the turns, and even still, I made a wrong turn. But anyway, it helps me get from here to there, helps you get, and I lean on it now because I like to not think when I drive. I don't really want to think too hard. Just tell me where to go. Just show me the way. And you just push the data in, and there we go. So 2,000 plus satellites surround our entire globe now. It gives us more information of things. Helps us know where we're going. The funny thing is, with 2,000 satellites up in the air, the funny thing is it helps us to know something we already kind of knew. You are here. You are here. Good news. Now we know exactly where you are. And you kind of are always where you are. You are here on the globe. Now not just you know, but everybody knows where you are on the globe. That's kind of a whole other sermon, but anyway, whole other sermon. But now you know where you are in the world. That's kind of helpful information, I guess. You know where you are in the world because you have to start with the destination. And my phone, even though I keep turning it off because it bothers me a little bit, it still wants to say, you know, tell me where you are. Do you want me to flip this back on? Because when I want to go over there, it needs to know where you are first. So we need to know point A in order to get to point B, right? Okay, so we need to know where you are to start with, and then we can help you to get where you're going. So, you know, the simplest of things, the simplest of things, how to get from point A to point B. It could be a 10-minute ride, it could be a 2-hour ride, it could be a long trip you're planning. But that one little activity has us super excited about 2,000 satellites floating around the globe to just help us get from point A to point B. We think that's a really, really cool thing. It is doing a whole lot of other things we probably have no idea about, but the global positioning system, you are here, it helps you know where you're going. Isn't that incredible? We can set that up as human beings, that we made up the system. I still think it's amazing. Our knowledge has increased. What does that say, I ask myself, about what I already believe to be true about what God can know about me and what God can know about everybody else in the world? His all-knowingness. It actually helps me say, you know, if we can figure out this much about where we are and where we're headed, maybe I can trust even more so that God is really cool and actually he can know where I am at all times and where you are at all times. Amazing. That's kind of a cool thought. And then I thought, God is more intelligent than our own intelligence. Wouldn't you agree, at least in that rational next step of thinking? We believe he can figure this out even more than we can with 2,000. I bet we're trying to put a lot more satellites up there, aren't we, than 2,000. Cover the whole earth so we know, have more information. So if God can know more than we in our own intellect can kind of create in this GPS system, what can he help us with that we can't help ourselves with in this level of intellect? Let me go this place. We can figure out where we are all across the globe and where we want to go, even in remote situations. Even in remote situations, you can now, just not in your own car, you can carry your GPS with you on a back road trip out into nowhere's land with no roads, no maps. You can know kind of where you are, even in those untrackable places in the world. That's really cool. But one thing you can't do, one thing this GPS system can't do yet for me, is help me best decide where I should be going in the world. Now, there may come a time where she starts yelling at me, you know, about where I am, what I'm doing. She certainly tries to correct me frequently. I had one time I was traveling Seattle, and it was kind of new for us to have this little system in our car, and we left her voice on all the time. We don't listen to her voice anymore. Eventually, you turn the sound off. Do you turn your sound off? Yeah. But we were listening to her voice, and we were even calling her Veronica at the time. So Veronica was talking to us in the car, and we were Seattle trying to get from one place to another, and we had made a wrong turn, and we're trying, and she, and you hear her say, recalculating. It's supposed to be neutral, her tone, I think, but it sounds a little judgmental to me when she says kind of recalculating. And then she repeats it several times, so I feel a little offended in the moment, you know, just a little correction there. And as she recalculated for us this day in Seattle to get from here to there, if we didn't have our own level of intelligence to apply to the story, if we had followed her recommendations, we would have turned right, waited in line for half an hour to get on the ferry boat, to cross the ferry, the entire ferry, to get off the ferry and do a U-turn and get back on the ferry and come back over and then make another turn. We would have done a big U-turn by going across the ferry. So, you know, we've figured some things out, but you got to apply your intellect a little bit. So far, with even our best systems in place, a little bit. So we have opportunities to go anywhere in the world we want to go. And we have the means to even let it guide us about going here to there, But still yet, in the things that you know for sure, the biggest decisions we have to make is where we're going and why we're going there. Amen. Where we're going and why we're going there. And the big question that the Bible asks us is, what is driving you to go there? What's motivating you to go from here to there? Where are you headed? And what's causing you to head in that direction? We have so many questions on our mind. I'd like to invite you to open up your Bibles to this very, very precious space in time where I believe David is pondering some things. He has been doing things. He has been going from here to there. He actually even has a story of his own life that he was early chosen by God to go great places. You know the story of David being chosen. He has been chosen as a child. He was the youngest in his group. And if you were going to, you know, have a great and wonderful life, that a prophet would come to your family, and when you weren't even recognized, you had no voice at all because you're the youngest child, you're not going to receive the inheritance of the promised first child, and your father is just sending you out into the field to shepherd the day that a very important man is coming to the house, and your father lines up everybody else from oldest to youngest in line, and you are there to go take care of the sheep. You're not even going to be considered. That's how little a voice you have about how this opportunity can affect your life. There's a lot of people in this country, and there's a lot of people in this church, and there's a lot of people in our families and circle of friends that are very frustrated because we don't have a voice. It's probably one of the things that frustrate us most. It's one of the ways that our relationships, our closest relationships, break down, is we feel unheard. Like, my part of what I need is not playing out in this relationship of intimacy. What are all the ways that that lack of voice, that lack of being seen, is driving you crazy and making you go and do things in your life? What's driving where you're going, and why are you going there? Well, David's, he's cast out, he has no voice, and then this prophet comes into town, and he looks at the oldest guy, proud, oldest, you know, invested in, looking sharp, tallest, everything, and he says, nope, not you. Goes down the line, nope, not you. Don't you have any other? And Father really has to think hard about that, because he thought, this was the best I had to offer. David comes out, this is the one. So God hears David. God hears David and pretty much says at an early age, you have a great future before you. You're probably David, now that we know in hindsight your life, you're going to make all kinds of choices of destination between here and there. You're going to do all kinds of things that do not seem to at all match where God destined you to go. Like that perfect, amazing, wonderful future vision of your life that he had for you. And if we could GPS your pathway, David, we'd say, what percentage of the time was he on track with God's vision? And what percentage of the time was he way off? There's, you know, but God has a vision. This is encouraging. God has a vision for each and every one of our futures. So it starts there. God created you and has a dream for your perfect life. Amen. And if we trust him and love his great intellect, he knows where we've been. He knows all the turns we make. He's recalculating all the time from whichever turn we make to help get us back. He's taking responsibility to get us back to ground zero should we ever listen to his voice calling out. Amazing. So that's really cool part of the story that helps us in our navigation. So we know that he did all kinds of things, David. You did all kinds of things. He had the blessing of experiencing power. God gave him power. 9 times out of 10, everything we're trying to do and all the places we're trying to go is to find a little power. Whoa. Dear Father, help me awaken to that one. Help me see that one. Because even in the name of good things, David, even in the name of leading my great nation, David, you're seeking for power so much so that you're way off path what I'm trying to plan for you. Oh, dear Father, help us with all the ways I seek power and hold on to power and fight back for power. How does that play out in our nation's story today? How does that play out in where I'm choosing to go today? With everything, everything. And then love, David. Love and relationships, David. One of the best VeggieTale versions of your story, David. It's my favorite. So you should look that up if you haven't seen King George and the Rubber Ducky. It's the perfect version of David and your relationship stories. David, yeah, you are way off base on love. Love is a motivation for the places we choose to go and why we choose to go there. And to what degree are we off course with God's version of what he promises to give? Perfect, holy, eternal love. Edifying, satisfying love. But we are so off course that we're not finding that. And just plain success, David, if you're going to be king of the world, wouldn't it be nice that you have a reputation that those around you, seeing you do what you've done, you've been successful in your assignment that God called you to produce something great for your people. You are king, you are leader, produce something great for your people. Way off base on success. So with all of those things that we fight for, goodness, power, avoiding pain, of not being seen, and a wanting purpose, all these things that motivate us in our choices of where I'm going from right here, we find this beautiful piece of writing from Psalms that I think is so tender, of a man who, in spite of all those wrong turns and all those recalculating voices of angelic hosts looking down upon David's life from called point one, saw a man after God's own heart. Amen. If you would open your Bibles to Psalm 119, one of the longest chapters in our Psalms, verse 136. This touches me. This touches me. And when it comes to what you know for sure, I think this is the beginning of the heart of what David might answer. This tender moment of all the decisions I've been making and the whys behind those decisions. Verse 136 says, streams of tears flow from my eyes. Can you imagine David in his quiet moment writing things down? And in his pondering of his life moment today, streams of tears are flowing from his eyes. We've all been there too. It's not working out, Lord, like I planned. And I'm frustrated. And I've messed up. But he sees something that he longs for still through the tears. For your law, your ways, your places to go, everything worthy of praise is not obeyed in me. You can't say that. You can't have tears about that unless you have a glimpse of what it could be. Unless you begin to see his goodness, unless you've learned from your mistakes and your twists and turns. We've learned from our mistakes, have we not? We're all here today because we've learned from some mistakes and some twists and turns, and we're still trying to answer the question of what I know for sure about all that I've been through. The beginning of that little section says, Your statutes, God, are wonderful. Therefore, I obey them. The unfolding of your words gives light. It really does in this world. It gives understanding to the simple-minded person that I am, the little shepherd boy, youngest in my tribe. I open my mouth and I'm actually panting like cotton mouth, longing for your commands, your ways, that voice coming to me saying, turn left, no, turn right. Turn to me, God, and have mercy on me, as you always do to those who love your name. Direct my footsteps according to your word, and let no sin rule over me. Redeem me from the oppression of men all around me, that I may obey your precepts. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and teach me your ways. That's a man who's longing, like all of us today are longing. And longing not just for the list of rules, because the list of rules and religiosity can be oppressive people and voices that just feel a little condemning, little judgmental, recalculating voice repeated several times, and actually get in the way of finding the way. Now, here's the thing. God knows this. God knows this. God sent his law into the world to guide us. But the law all by itself sounds like Veronica crying out, recalculate. And all it does is tell you you're not where you're supposed to be. But it all by itself is our version of a GPS system that can't help you get to where you should be going between what you know isn't good and where you hope God wants you to be. So one thing I know for sure is something that I want to study for all my day. It's something, as the pastor here in this group, I want to get to know you better, and I want to talk heart to heart. I want to encourage you, because I can't get to everybody, to befriend one another in this space and talk heart to heart. Because we have something to learn that's amazing. Because God is more intelligent than 2,000 satellites we know how to put into the sky. And he knows the turns we've made. And when he sends his word into the universe, it comes in the form of his son. And when his son speaks to you, off track though we are, we do not hear in his voice a tone of condemnation. Amen. Instead, God sent his son into the world. And you know what they called his son? The followers after him were changed dramatically, and they knew it became an underground movement, because there are forces above that will stop you from going this direction. And you will feel it, and you feel it all the way around. And so this became an underground movement. And they would write little symbols on the walls of places that they had been, because they're going new places they had never gone before. They had been doing all the things, even good things, but they were not finding anything except selfish power, bad relationships, and voices that don't get heard. And now in the sun, they heard something different and something shifted. And now they are listening to a different voice, and they are going new places on the same roads. And their why and their drive and their motivation is completely different. I want to know what changed them. I want to know what they heard. I want to know how he does it, how God can change my sinful, hard-hearted heart. I want to know more about that, which I know for sure. God sent his son. And listen, we know it for sure because it comes to us still in that still small voice here today. It is whispering in your ear that said, I know you're tired, but put your clothes on and go to church. And you listened and you said, but I don't know if I can see your way even there. And he says, I know. But you went anyway because you heard the still small voice and you're seeking him, that little tiny voice. And only through his power does he continue to speak through any of us inhuman or imperfect, selfish people. He does something in between because he can communicate like no other. And you know what they did? It went underground and they started to file in a different way. And I wonder if GPS could show one day in the future how the underground pathway of God's followers look in the world, in the universe, and where we go and why. But you could see, and it's recorded, that they would make these little signs. They would make something, this little curve that went like this, and this little curve that went like this, and we stick it on our cars nowadays, on the back of our cars. And these little symbols look like a fish, and it was called the way. Jesus is the way. He's the way. Through the Son of God, we've found the way. The way to what? The way to true love. The way to real power. The way to sacrificial giving that creates intimacy and love. The way to true success that brings me friendships and family and everything that at the end of my life I will say was worth it. That's the way he's offering to us. One of these movies, Mel Gibson, we've all gotten excited about Mel Gibson telling our story. Desmond Doss, way to go. Didn't he do a good job? If you've watched it, war is hard to see, but those who know war say, you know what, that's how hard it is. And we could barely imagine our Desmond Doss. I'm thinking a movie back. It was very hard to attend that one. There was a lot of controversy on whether or not we even should attend that one, but I did. And I decided that I don't like pain. I don't like pain. I don't like pain enough that the average day, halfway through my exercise routine, I'm calling it quits. Like, oh, that's feeling good at first. I'm so proud of myself. Oh, that hurts. Let's slow down. So. I was not excited, and I certainly don't like watching pain. I was the one that always got stuck at the side of the bus, right by the window, when the fight broke out outside of the bus. And I don't know why everybody gathers to behold this thing. I don't like it, so I wasn't excited to see it. So I don't like pain, so I wasn't excited to go and watch this very painful depiction of the Son of God, the way, dying on the cross for me. I wasn't excited to put it in my mind. And I really didn't want everybody to watch me watching it. So I didn't go in one of those big groups and went all by myself to watch this movie. Half the time, I sat like this, peeking through. And it was very, very painful. And throughout the course of the film, I am present to the pain of the Son of God. And the pain of the Son of God is coming by the hands of his creation. My story, your story, his people who he had just served. We are abusing him. We are beating him. We are crushing his body. He had every nerve that I have, and he is enduring this awful, awful thing. So I am present to pain in the movie. There comes a point in time in the film when mother shows up. I'm a mother, so I'm connecting to mom. Not like Mary the Holy, but mom. And in the story, Mel Gibson shows her coming up to him mid-walk, Gethsemane, cross on his back, having endured this. And you know, she was chasing this down. There's not a parent knowing their son is being crucified over there that stays home. So I believe she's trying to figure this out. She's trying to get close. I think she's losing her mind. I think she's pulling people in. I think she's calling the disciples. I think she's frantic trying to stop it. I think she's there. And she comes up, and Mel gives her a space in the movie where she actually gets to see him eye to eye in the middle of the pain. Now, if I am in the middle of my deepest pain, and I've been holding it in to to survive this. And anyone I love comes up to me and just looks at me. What do you do? I'm gonna lose it. I lose it, I do the ugly cry, I talk about all my pain, I explain it thoroughly, and I just lose it. And if I'm in a public place, like I've had moments, I don't know, I'm just sharing. I had moments where, you know, you're trying to, whatever, something happened, and a friend will come up and you're in a public moment and they'll look at you, are you okay? And I'm like, don't. I know you can see through me, but I am holding it together right now. So when I see Mary going up to the Son of God in all this pain, I'm hanging on in the movie waiting for his response. And I'm expecting it to be just like mine. But the Son of God is the way. He loves you. God loves you. And in the movie, if you remember, the response of the Son of God was not a blubbery moment of telling Mother everything that's hurting me. Did you see what they did to me, Mary? Did you see how my creation is treating me? This really hurts. And it doesn't just hurt physically, it hurts emotionally. He didn't go there. You know what he said in the movie? Mother, I am making all things new. I'm making all things new. The Son of God, and I looked in my Bible, I went home from that day, because this moved me so much. This moved me so much in the moment, because they had shown prior. They showed prior Mary reflecting back on her son. And whenever my son even falls, and they imagined her as a mother, and Son of God trips on a rock and skins a knee, and she's about ready to kill herself to save him from skinning a knee. And right now what she wants to do to stop him from dying on this cross. Everything she could do to stop it, she would. And I can relate to this, but Jesus is the way. And he's going to help us find a new way to find power, a new way to find love, a new way to find your voice, a new way to live, a new way to know success, a new way for everything. And the Bible does say in Revelation, this great proclamation, behold, God, we have made all things new. We have made all things new. God sent his son, Jesus, to die for you. When we do our climbs to our mountaintops, when I put a destination into my GPS, say, I want to climb the mountain of success in my life. And I begin heading there. If in the name of Jesus we are the way, before we go anywhere else, he's going to lead us to the cross first. At the top of every spiritual GPS mountain you and I are on, he's going to lead us to the cross. And this I know for sure. In the cross is the answer to my every dilemma. In the cross is my hope to understand my true power. In the cross is my source of every forgiveness process that leads to deeper intimacy in every relationship that will satisfy. In the cross is the hope of everything. Religiously speaking, everything I know to be true on the list of on that Ten Commandments will find its true meaning on the other side of the cross. Amen. And not before. Before, in my power, it will only be about my power, even good things. How I keep the Sabbath, what I know is true, I will use like Veronica on everybody, including myself. Jesus says, I am the way. I am the way. And it went underground after they saw him die. They saw him die at their own hands, and the preachers came and they reminded him of what they had done in their own power. We killed you. David is crying, weeping, streams of tears, saying, God, I know your way, but I have failed you. I have killed a man. I have stolen a woman. I have used my power for my own glory. And all I really want is what you have to offer in streams of tears. Show me the way. Show me the way. And the God of heaven sends his son to the gallows. For in the gallows, you find your way. That's so contrary to my GPS system. We still need a phone or a mechanism in my car to access those 2,000 satellites. I'm actually trying to track our children's story devotionals on Bible and maps today. What I know for sure about this map that we have tenderly placed in our hand from generations of people who've been trying to tell us what they know for sure, passed down from one generation to another, is that Jesus is the way. And if we preach the cross and if we lift it high and if we submit ourselves to everything in him, if we submit ourselves to each other and not try to go over ahead of each other, if we submit, the Bible says, before it talks about how we should submit, it says everybody submit to each other. Everybody submit to each other and first submit to God and then submit to each other. And in doing so, let God, who can see past all of our 2,000 satellites at a higher level into your heart, help you find where you should go and why in the rest of your days. Let him be your navigator. For when you reach the top of your mountaintop, and if you should meet the cross there, he may just turn us around and show us eternity, full of love and joy and peace that passes all understanding. This I know for sure, and I know nothing at the same time.